Right, I'd like you to turn with me, please, if you would, in your Bibles to Psalm 85. Psalm 85, as we continue on this topic of revival. And somebody reminded me that this is number 7 in terms of messages on revival. And some of you might be thinking, is there anything else you can say about revival? Let me tell you, there was a preacher in London. His name was Martin Lloyd-Jones. And in the anniversary of the 1859 revival, so in 1959, he decided that on every Sunday morning for 52 weeks, he would preach a sermon on revival, and he did it for 52 weeks. So you've only got 7 messages, right? There's a lot more to go. This is a fabulous subject, and again, let's break in Psalm 85, verse 6, and it's the cry of the psalmist, and I believe the cry of some of us here at Hillview, and some that were there yesterday at the Bay Area Revival Day of Prayer and Fasting. And the heart cry is simply this: wilt thou not, or will you not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee? Show us thy mercy, O Lord, and grant us thy salvation. And so the psalmist, part of the Old Testament people of God, recognized that things weren't the way they ought to be, and he knew the history of God's dealings with his people. And the way it kind of goes throughout Scripture and throughout church history is something like this: that the people of God start well, and then they drift, and they get away from the Lord, and they kind of, you know, get far away from the Lord, and they get into a mess. Because sin is always spoils everything, doesn't it? So they kind of get backslidden and all this kind of stuff, and they cry out to the Lord, and then the Lord revives them. And if you follow the history of Israel, you'll see this cyclical thing of doing well, failing, crying out to God, God reviving them, and they're enjoying his presence and his fellowship again. And then it happens all. And the history of the church is just like that. But do you like history? Anybody here like history? I love history, okay? So this is going to be a bit different this morning, because I want to look at revival, because we're saying, will you revive us again? Well, what's it going to look like? Like, if the Lord does send revival to Hillview, do you think you'd like it? Do you even know what it would look like, right? It's a good question, isn't it? What are we actually praying for? Well, I'm a bit nervous about this. What is it going to do to us? Okay, well, I want to look at history and Scripture, because it's always people, revival. This, no offense to my Indian brethren here, but sometimes Indians have a problem saying the letter B. Sometimes they say letter V. Sometimes they say B. Is that correct? So they say, instead of revival, sometimes they'll say revival. Well, that's not wrong. Not at all, right? It's actually correct, because revival is getting back to the Bible. So even though we're looking at history, it'll be very biblical as well, because what is revival? Let me give you 3 simple points about what revival is. This is what we're praying for. Will you not revive us again? Let's say this: it's an extraordinary work of God. And what I mean by that is, it's not the normal work of God, but it's extraordinary. It's when God does things that only God can do in a very special, marvelous way. And so when we look at some of the events of revival, we'll say, wow, I've never seen anything like that. That's why we're praying for it. We want to see it. But it's God acting in an extraordinary way in the church. And I want to just say this, that while we're praying for revival, looking for the extraordinary work of God, we still have to keep going with the ordinary work of God. One of the problems is we can be so desperate for revival that we fail to do that which is right in front of us, right? So I still need to be faithful in serving God now and doing all that I know to do, but still crying out, God, will you not revive us again? Will you not do this extraordinary work that I'd love to see? Part of the extraordinary work of God in revival is what we would say is this: a new sense of the presence of God amongst his people. The unique presence of God. And what I mean by that is that God's presence is so tangible and so real that everybody knows God is here. There's a revival on a little Scottish island called the Isle of Lewis, 1949. And the presence of God was so real on the Isle of Lewis during that revival that people in a dance, now these are young people in a dance doing their thing, and the presence of God became so present on that island that people fled out of the dance like the building was on fire. And they ran to the church crying out, "What must I do to be saved?" Now, I don't, has that ever happened in Hillview where people have just ran in from a disco or whatever they do nowadays, a rave party, or I don't know, I'm kind of an old guy. Discos was my thing, so this is a different, I didn't get saved until I was 20, just in case you were thinking I was a Christian going to discos. I wasn't. But can you imagine what it would be like? People kind of coming through the doors in agony of soul, crying out, "What must I do to be saved?" That's what happens during revival, that kind of thing. I said yesterday that there's a true account of ships coming into New York Harbor in 1857, 1858, when the prayer revival was going on, and people sensing the presence and holiness of God as they got close to these shores, getting converted on the ship before they even came to the shore. Such was the presence of God. So it's this unique presence of God. By the way, if the presence of God came amongst us, what do you think had happened to us this morning? You know what I think? I think we might hit the dust. Whenever God appears in his glory, you know what people do? They fall on their face like dead men. We might just be all sprawled out. See, do you want revival? I mean, that might be a bit disorderly. You know what I'm saying? Do we really want that? I'd love to see that, wouldn't you? Amen. The real presence of God. Well, that's what happens during revival. And revival, we said, it really begins with the people of God getting right with God and acting like Christians. And so it always starts with us. But when we start acting like we're supposed to, then we become burdened for souls like the Savior is. And as a result of the church being revived, there usually is a big awakening among the general population. And lots of people get saved. So, how many times has God brought revival to the church? Well, I have a list of revivals here. In fact, I probably should give somebody this to copy so that you could, if you wanted to distribute it, you could, because it's kind of hard to take notes of it all. Usually, every 50 or so years maybe, I mean, the last ones that we know of, I know of one on a little island in the Bahamas that happened 2013-14. Amazing work of God on that island. So God is still doing it today, by the way. And what I mean, why that was so significant was so many people came to Christ, and it began when elders in a church repented of their cold-heartedness. That was the starting point. It's amazing. And then a lot of people who had been seeking salvation, some of them, one guy, he was on drugs and had for years wanted to be saved, but just couldn't seem to get it. And when the revival came, he was one of the first ones to get it. And you should see that guy now. Clean of drugs, all the rest of it, just living wholeheartedly for the Lord. Amazing work of God. And I've seen the evidence of that, and what a tremendous thing. Sometimes people say, well, how come the word revival, like I've just read from this verse, Psalm 85, and this earlier session I was on, Isaiah 57, and you might say, well, how come you don't use any New Testament verses? Because the word revival actually is not in the New Testament. Mind you, the word Trinity is not in the New Testament either, but the truth of it is, right? So we've got to be careful about that. But the word's not there. So how come it's not there? Well, for one reason, for the most part, the early days of the church was a revival, wasn't it? The presence of God was there in the Acts of the Apostles. People were getting saved in their droves, weren't they? 3,000 in one sermon. I mean, I say when I preach and somebody gets saved, I'm as high as a kite for a week. Can you imagine what Peter must have been like? One sermon, 3,000 converts. I don't know if I could live with myself. I'd be so excited, you know? And so this is what happens during revival. The New Testament church was a church in revival. But by the time you get to the book of Revelation and what we looked at yesterday, the seven churches, AD 95. By the time you get to AD 95, five out of the seven churches, the Lord Jesus says, you need to repent. So what's happened? Well, it's that downward cycle again, right? Started out well, started out vibrant, on fire, everything's going wonderful, but by the time you get to AD 95, there's a need for repentance. So, and of course, we said yesterday, repentance always precedes revival. So, historically, I'm going to give you a lot of a letter P today, okay? Kind of outline all with P so you can remember. You can make a list of these letter P's if you want to do that. But one of the things about revival is that it usually comes when conditions are pitiful, when things are bad. One of the wonderful things about history is it gives you perspective. Sometimes we think we're it, and this is the, you know, kind of we're unique in human history, and it's never been like this before, and the things that we're going through are so unique, and woe is us, and what a pathetic little generation we are. If you knew anything about history, you'd realize it's been as bad as this before, and even worse. Okay? And so part of that mentality is because things are bleak right now, we say, oh, we must be living in the end times. I'm expecting the Lord to come at any moment, but let me tell you this, that just because things are bleak doesn't necessarily mean we're in the end times. Things have been bleak before, many times throughout history. So let me tell you about some of the pitiful conditions. Let me tell you about the times of the Wesleyan revival. Do you remember, the name John Wesley and Charles Wesley and George Whitefield and that great revival that occurred in England? Well, things were pretty dark then. I just read, I think probably my sixth biography of John Wesley. He's one of my heroes. And this one is probably the best, by a guy called John Telford. And he talks about London at the time of the Wesleys. And he says that every sixth house in London was what they called a grog shop. That's where they sold gin. Okay? In those days, people drank gin because you could get drunk pretty quick with it. And they would sell, for a penny, enough gin to get you dead drunk. For two pennies, they'd have straw in the basement, you could sleep it off. These drunks that would be in, remember, this is every sixth house is a gin stock shop. They'd get drunk, and in packs, one of the things they used to do for fun in those days is they'd run out on the streets of London, and they'd grab an ordinary citizen, and they would, just for fun, pin them down on the ground and gouge their eyeballs out. Now, you think it's bad here? I don't feel any threat that anybody's going to do that to me. At least in Springfield, Missouri. I don't know if I would do that here in Cupertino or whatever, but or wherever we are. Anyway, but that's how bad it was. The clergy were the leaders, in a sense. If you wanted to know how to live a debauched life, the clergy of the Church of England were your role models. They were the drunkards. They were the card gamblers and all this kind of stuff. And so things were bleak. In fact, one historian says this. It says, these times were the darkest age that England has passed through in the last 300 years. That's how bad it was. And when the Whitfield and Wesley brothers began to preach, it changed everything. The whole country was affected by the gospel of Jesus Christ. Isn't that wonderful? And it was a mighty revival. It really was. The United States, 1790... historian says, religion had sadly declined during the previous years. Unitarianism had gained much ground. That means that people don't believe in the triunity of God. They just believe that God is God, but they don't believe Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And that was a big thing. And then infidel philosophy was poisoning the minds of millions of people. Darkness of death hung over the world at that time. So all I'm saying is that just because it's dark doesn't mean that God can't work. In fact, my Bible says this, where sin abounds, grace does yet more abound. Isn't that what it says? Now, do you believe that? Do you believe what God says? Do you believe that He is able to save to the uttermost those that come to God by Him? Do you believe that? See, it doesn't matter how dark it is. God specializes in saving hopeless cases.
Amen.
When I was Catholic, we used to have a patron saint called Saint Jude. And he was the patron saint of hopeless cases. And if you were a hopeless case, you'd pray to Saint Jude. And my wife said, I bet a lot of people were praying to Saint Jude for you. But Saint Jude couldn't help me. Jesus Christ could help me. And He's able to save the worst and make them the best. Isn't that amazing? That's what the Lord Jesus does. And so pitiful conditions are just an opportunity for God to show Himself to be God. So the second P is prayer. And of course, we've been emphasizing that, trying to emphasize that. Yesterday was a beginning of our journey, I hope, in prayer. But let me tell you, just from the history of the Bible and church history, there's never been a revival that didn't begin with a new burden to pray amongst the people of God. In fact, wherever there's a revival, find the praying people. And it's not necessarily a lot of people. Sometimes it could just be a handful of people that are crying out to God for revival. And here's the psalmist. What is he doing? Will you not revive us again? Is that a prayer? I think it's a prayer, isn't it? He's crying out to God. Will you not revive us again that your people might rejoice in you? That the people of God might not be discouraged and disheartened, but be filled with joy at witnessing God working in their generation. Will you not revive us again? So prayer is definitely kind of integral to the whole revival thing. Matthew Henry, when God intends a great mercy for His people, the first thing He does is set them praying. That's the first thing He does. Evan Roberts, very involved in the Welsh Revival, 1904, somebody asked him, what's the great secret? He says, there is no secret. Ask and you shall receive. Right? What is the secret? Ask and you will receive. So we talked about examples of that yesterday, about people agonizing in prayer. And just turn with me to Colossians 2, just to show you another example of this agonizing in prayer. We looked at one in Colossians chapter 4, but in Colossians chapter 2, verse 1, Paul talks about his burden for them in Colossae. And he says in chapter 2, verse 1, for I would that you knew what great conflict I have for you, and for them at Laodicea, and for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh. And when he says, I want you to know what great conflict, the word that he uses there for conflict in the original language is a word agonia. Does that sound like a word we remember or know about? Agony. Don't you realize what agony I'm in for you at Laodicea and in Colossae? Isn't that amazing? He was agonizing over them. And we've talked about praying, and we don't really know a lot about this. We need the Lord to help us to know what it is to travail, to agonize over souls. Anybody here heard of David Brainerd? Okay. One, two. A few more. Praise the Lord. I'm happy. But there should be a lot more. My wife's favorite biography is the biography of David Brainerd. She read it as a young Christian, and it had a profound impact upon her life. My wife is a woman of prayer. Some people say, we never see your wife. That's okay. I like it where she is. She's praying for these meetings. And she is a woman of prayer. But David Brainerd helped shape her. And David Brainerd he worked amongst the North American Indians, indigenous people, First Nations, whatever politically correct you want to call them anymore. You can't call anybody anything anymore, but you know what they are. You know what I'm talking about. The original people that were here. And it's interesting that David Brainerd, this was in 1745, when a powerful revival occurred amongst the Indians. And he says, he's telling his story. He says, the 26th of July in the evening, God was pleased to help me in prayer beyond what I have experienced for some time. My soul was drawn out for the enlargement of Christ's kingdom and for the conversion of my poor people. I relied on God for the accomplishment of this great work. Now, let me tell you about David Brainard. David Brainard had tuberculosis, TB. That was a big thing in those days. And he was constantly burning up with a fever. And he would also cough up blood. Sometimes when he would cough up blood, it would come out almost like a bullet out of his mouth. Such was the force of the coming out of his lungs. He'd lay in the snow praying, and the snow would just melt because of the fever coursing through his body. He couldn't speak the dialect of the Indians that he was trying to reach, and he only had one man who was an Indian that spoke English and the tribal dialect, and he was a drunk. So you've got a guy who's riddled with TB. Oh, by the way, he was also somebody who was given to great bouts of depression as well. Now, this is our missionary hero, right? I mean, talk about weak. Just like Paul, when we think of Paul as this superhero, you know, with the cape crusader almost, you know how we tend to view him? He talks about going into Corinth in weakness and fear and much trembling. Is that how you imagine the Apostle Paul? I don't think so. That's exactly what he says as he went into Corinth. So here's this man, he's weak, he's burning up with fever, he's got this drunk Indian as his interpreter, and yet a tremendous revival occurs. Multitudes of these people are converted to Christ through a drunk interpreter. I mean, isn't that a God thing? And what he says is, God was pleased to help me in prayer beyond what I have experienced for some time. And that's how the revival came. And I think, can I just say this? I hope you don't think it's done just because we had that day yesterday. Lord, deliver us. If that's the case, we need help, right? And we need to say, Lord, help me to pray. I need help just like David Brainard needed help, right? I don't know about you, but when I get serious about prayer and I get a quiet place to pray, and immediately a to-do list crops up in my mind. I don't know if I'm the only one, but I have an active mind, and I just, and so all of a sudden there's all this stuff I got to do, and I literally have to pull myself, determine. Sometimes I stand up, sometimes I walk around the room, sometimes I put my arms up. I hope that doesn't offend you, but it keeps me awake, and I'm saying to God, look, God, I don't have anything to offer anyway. I have no bargaining chip. I want you to provide what's needed here, right? And so I do these strange things, but part of it is because it's a real effort to pray. It's not easy. And we need the help of God to pray. Praying in the Holy Spirit, Jude would say. And here that God gives him this tremendous help. And so lots of other examples. I could go through tons of examples. Anybody heard of Charles Grandison Finney? Charles Grandison Finney was in Rochester, New York, late 1800s, a lot of revivals under his ministry. But if you've heard of Finney, you probably may not have heard that there were two other men that were involved during Finney's revival, Abel Clary and Daniel Nash. Anybody ever heard of Abel Clary and Daniel Nash? Both of them were preachers who couldn't preach. Now, it wasn't that they weren't eloquent, but they were so burdened for souls that they couldn't preach. They just had to pray. They were compelled to pray. And so these men actually hardly ever preached, even though they were licensed preachers. And they would just devote themselves to prayer, and they were praying about the area around Rochester, New York, where these revivals broke out. And they would pray about a town, and they pray for the souls in that town. They pray for souls to be saved. And Finney would go and have gospel campaigns there, and multitudes would be saved. And what they found afterwards is the very places that Finney went were places that Abel Clary and Daniel Nash had been praying for. And he didn't even realize it. When Abel Clary died, the blessing in Finney's gospel campaign dried up. He still preached, but nobody was getting saved. See, we need some Abel Clarys today. Hillview needs some Abel Clarys and some Daniel Nashes, who may never take the platform, but they'll go into the closet and pray that anybody that takes this platform will be clothed with power from on high and will preach in the power of the Holy Spirit and lives will be converted. That's what we need, is people will take that place. And so I can show you again and again and again, example after example of revivals, and I can say, well, let me find the person who was praying or people who were praying, and I can find those people. And history testifies these great heroes of whom the world was not worthy. Isn't it amazing? What a day it's going to be when we get to glory and we'll think about, oh, I'm going to meet all these big shots. And then we're going to see people like Abel Clary probably a lot closer to the throne of God than people like Charles Grandison Finney. Right? What work is being done in the quiet place in prayer? And so, can I ask you, I mean, let's make it practical. How's your prayer life doing? I'm not talking about yesterday. I'm talking about every day. Do you spend much time in the presence of God? Are you a man of prayer or a woman of prayer? Do you just love to spend time in His presence crying out to God for lost souls, for people you know, for the servants of God? You know, there's not much human glory in that, is there? Really? But you know, we're our society is a society where you've got to be seen to be doing something. And so people like Abel Clary just weren't seen. They were in the closet the whole time. Nobody saw them. I'm hoping there are some like that that we don't see today but are doing those things. But they're rare birds. I want to tell you, they're really rare birds. I have some people like that. I have one lady gets up at 4 o'clock every morning to pray for my ministry. Every single day. Isn't that amazing? When she told me that, I didn't know. And she told me, she said, I do that every day for you. I said to her, if you'd have given me a bar of gold, it wouldn't have meant as much as what you just told me. Isn't that thrilling? Another guy, he'll be praying right now, Gary Miller. He'll be praying for you guys. He said that he's given himself, his hero is Abel Clary. And he said, Mike, I want to tell you, I've given myself to the ministry of intercession. And that's what I do. And he said, you're on my list. Amen. Praise the Lord, huh? Yeah. We need those kind of people. So there's prayer, and then there's preaching. Now, there's always been preaching. But there's preaching and there's preaching. Yeah. And during times of revival, people who preach have extraordinary power in their preaching. Some people use terms like they were baptized with the Holy Ghost. Now, we get nervous about that kind of language and all the rest of it. But back in those days, they would use those kind of terms for somebody's preaching that was extraordinary, powerful. God was using them in an amazing way. And, you know, one of the problems we have, and look with me, please, to Acts 2 for a second. Acts chapter 2. I think one of the problems we have is that we have, and I said this yesterday, I said it again, we've got this bias against the Holy Spirit. We're scared to death of Him. We don't want to be crazy charismatics. And so, as a result, there's a dullness about us. But when you see the day of Pentecost, notice it says in chapter 2 of Acts, verse 1, it says, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting, and there appeared to them cloven tongues like a fire, and it sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And so there's this infilling by the Holy Spirit, and later on they're going to stand together, Peter with the 11, and they're going to preach to a mob. And Peter, who was a coward, who had, remember, a lot of boasting, but when he faced the mob, he denied the Lord with oaths and cursings. Remember that? Now that same man, empowered by the Spirit of God, is going to look at the same mob and stare them down, eyeball to eyeball. And he's going to say, you crucified your own Messiah. You need to repent. And you say, wow, what a transformation. What happened to Peter? I'll tell you what happened to Peter. He got the Spirit of God. And the Spirit of God gave him a holy boldness. Now, we tend to have this theology that the Spirit came on Acts chapter 2, and we got everything, and that's it, we're done. Right? Isn't that dispensationalism 101? Right? And not to expect anything else. You got everything. So how come we're so dead and lifeless? Look at Acts chapter 4. Verse 31, when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. This is the same group, folks, that were there in Acts chapter 2, and in Acts chapter 4, they get a fresh infilling and empowerment to preach the gospel again. They got it in chapter 2, they got it again in Acts chapter 4. What does that tell you? It means we need fresh empowerment from the Spirit of God, don't we? Yesterday's victory doesn't do me any good today, does it? As a preacher, there's been times where you've had tremendous help, but you can't rely on the fact that I had help last time I preached. You say, Lord, here I am again. I'm a needy man. I need your help today. If you're not filled with the Spirit, I don't even want to go up there. Right? Because if it's just me, it's not going to have any effect whatsoever. And so the preaching is that which is empowered by the Spirit of God, and it has a profound effect. In fact, there's a power connected with that preaching, and we said it's the power of the Spirit. I'm going to give you a quote from R.A. Torrey. He says this, "There are some who seek to magnify the Spirit, but neglect the Word. This will not do at all. Fanaticism, baseless enthusiasm, wildfire are the result. Others seek to magnify the Word, but largely ignore the Spirit. Neither will this do. It leads to dead orthodoxy, truth without life and power." Which group do you think we're most like? Second one, right? Great emphasis on the Word, but you know what it produces? The Word without the Spirit? Dead orthodoxy. And I'll tell you, that's us. For the most part, we dot the I's, we cross the T's, and we've got it all together as far as the Word is concerned, at least we think we have, and yet we're not impacting the world. Many of our assemblies, if you are as a visiting preacher, I'm often trying to find assemblies. And so my GPS sometimes helps and sometimes it doesn't. It's a double-minded machine. You know, sometimes it gets you there, sometimes it gets you in a mess, right? But so anyway, sometimes I have to ask, can you tell me where the church is? And I'm like a block away. And people say, oh, I've never heard of it. Isn't that sad? I wonder if there are people a block away from here that have ever heard of Hillview. The church in Thessalonica, everybody heard about them. Says the word of God trumpeted out from them. So we don't have to say anything, Paul says. It spread out to surrounding provinces. Everybody knew about them. Isn't that amazing? And they preached in the power of the Spirit of God. The word of God came to Thessalonica, not in word only, but in power and much authority and in the Holy Ghost, it says. And we need that power. D.L. Moody said, I need that power. He was crying to God all the time. Fill me with your Spirit. And I've told this before, I'm not going to go through it in detail, but he did get an experience with God where he experienced the fullness and power of the Holy Spirit. And he says that his preaching was the same sermons, but altogether different effect. Now, I don't know, Rick, would you like to preach the same sermons and have a different effect?
A better effect, yes.
Yeah. People getting saved, like left, right, and center. Wouldn't that be something else? That's what happened with D.L. Moody. That's exactly what happened to Dale Moody. Oftentimes, in times of revival, because the presence of God is so real, we talked earlier about people hitting the deck. It wouldn't be uncommon for people to fall prostrate under the preaching of the Word of God. During Wesley's preaching, sometimes there were as many as 1,800 people on the ground in agony of soul for hours after he preached. Isn't that amazing? It's hard to even believe that, isn't it, today? Like, I'm not talking fantasy, this is real. It really is documented. But such was the power in those days. Do you think we need revival, really? I mean, do you think we really need this? Anybody here think we're okay? See, that's the problem. Some of us think we're okay. Some of us have come to think that this lukewarm thing we call Christianity is actually normal. It isn't. It's not what I read in the book of Acts. It's not what I read in Thessalonica. It's not normal. And along with this prostration on the ground, there's genuine penitence. There, we talked about repentance, and there's great stories of this happening where people, just like Zacchaeus. Remember when Zacchaeus met the Lord, and he said, "If I've swindled anybody, I'm going to pay him back how many? Fourfold." Remember that? I mean, this guy was genuinely a broken man. He wanted to put things right from his past, and he went about doing that. And during revival, those kind of things happen. People want to put things right. They want to make relationships right. They go and see people they've offended and try and put it right. They go and pay debts that they owe, and they do everything they can because they're just changed people. And they realize that in their unsaved state, they did a lot of damage and hurt. And as much as they can possibly do, they want to put it right. It's a wonderful thing to see that, isn't it? When you witness that, it has an impact. I've seen that happen with people. And I've seen the impact of it. People taking library books back and paying fines, and they'd stolen the book 25 years ago, and the fine was outrageously high, but it bothered their conscience that they still had that book, and they had taken it and not returned it. And now they got saved, they became a new creature, and they want to put it right. And I can tell you lots of stories like that. And that's the kind of thing that happens in revival. And that's why people take notice. They see the reality of it. It also results in tremendous praise. Many of the great hymn movements were resulted as a result of revival. The Welsh revival, there was a kind of a theme song. It's called "Love Vast as the Ocean." I don't know if you've ever, you can go on YouTube and listen to a Welsh choir singing "Love Vast as the Ocean." But they said that was everywhere. You could hear it down the pits. People would be singing that down the coal mines. It was everywhere in the community. People were singing this song, because it was connected with what God the Holy Spirit was doing in the time of revival. The Catholic Church was so incensed at Luther's "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God," because they said, even if you go to the blacksmith, as he's beaten out, he's singing "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." Isn't that amazing? It was everywhere. The hymns of Wesley permeated Britain in that revival. And there's always the people of God, because Psalm 85, remember, "Will you not revive us again, that your people might rejoice in you?" And one of the ways we express our joy is we sing, right? And it comes out, and we can't help but do it. And it's one of the evidences, by the way, of being filled with the Spirit. If you look at Ephesians 5, it's singing to one another in psalms and hymns, spiritual songs, making melody in your heart to the Lord, right? And that's one of the outflows of the Spirit-filled life. And so you get a whole community that are experiencing the power of the Spirit of God, and they sing. And it's a wonderful thing. Sometimes we try to sing and get people singing, and yet we're trying to manipulate people to show signs of reality and revival, and their hearts are just not in it. You ever notice that? Sometimes it's like that, isn't it? In revival, you can't help it. What does it say? "He brought me out of the pit, put me on a rock, put a new song in my heart, even praise to our God." And that's what happens when genuine revival occurs. There's a song. And then there's a passion for souls, reaching out to lost souls everywhere. It's a natural outflow. When you've got Christ and you're in love with Him in times of revival, it's so real that people will cross land and sea to tell some person about the Savior. Now it's hard to get us to even cross the street to tell somebody about the Savior, isn't it? You know, by the way, every time there's a massive revival, there's also a massive missionary movement. A direct result of revival is a tremendous impulsion to missions. It's amazing. We want to see the world reached. You know what we need? Sometimes people say, well, you know, we just need to get involved in missions. I say, yeah, get involved in missions, but you know what? Let's get involved and see revival occur. Because we can't manufacture it, it comes by God. But we can pray, will you not revive us again, that your people might rejoice in you. Can I ask you to pray for revival? I mean, not just, we had that day, and I don't know how many of you were at that day. I know some of you were there. It was a great day. You know, I don't know if anybody else felt that way, but I couldn't believe how quick the day went. Like, when you start out, you're going to pray from 10 till 4:15. It's like going to the dentist, isn't it? I mean, that's a long day. It wasn't a long day. It flew. It was amazing. And when you get a taste for that, we have the week of prayer, May 1st through 5th, Kansas City. Costs the same price to fly here as it does to fly there. So you could, I can come here, you can go there. And let me tell you, that week is amazing. People come, and we've had people say to us, we had one guy came, he says, I don't know why I'm here, I hate assembly prayer meetings, they're absolutely boring, and I've signed up for a week of this. When he left, he was so pumped, he said, I got to start one of these in my area. Now there's an Ontario Day of Prayer as a result. He caught it. I want you to catch it. I want you to be, I just long to see Psalm 85, verse 6 and 7. Will you not revive us again? That your people might rejoice in you. I'd like to see the people of God no longer discouraged and hanging on till the rapture and thinking, oh boy, this is tough. But just filled with absolute joy at knowing him, at loving him, at seeing God work, the living God, in our generation. May the Lord help us and encourage us. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for the Word of God. We thank you that throughout the Word of God, we have so many examples of bleak times. We think of the revival during the days of Hezekiah. And before that, it was just awful. The temple was shut. The doors were bolted. There were idols everywhere in the land. And yet, here's a man who has a burden for seeing things turned around. And Hezekiah, a man of prayer, definitely a man of prayer. And all of a sudden, everything changes. In fact, the Bible talks about it happens suddenly. Lord, we ask that you would do that to us, to our generation. Would you bring revival? Lord, the conditions are bleak. There's no question about that. We're living in days of darkness, great darkness. But Lord, I understand that the light is supposed to shine all the brighter the darker it gets. And I'm asking that you would just light a flame, as it were, in our hearts, and we'd burn brightly for the Lord Jesus Christ. And we be used of you in seeing revival in this generation. We'll give you the glory. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, amen.